So with no further ado, I'll ask our first speaker, Professor Pinar Keskinocak, if you'll share your screen and I'll do a quick introduction. I am very fortunate to have known Pinar for several years here. She's one of my colleagues here at Georgia Tech and is a preeminent scholar in understanding and modeling disease, infectious disease, and a variety of related topics. We've decided to have her go first here today because she's going to give a basic understanding of how one goes about understanding and modeling the spread of disease and work she's done specific to COVID-19, both in the Atlanta, Georgia area and beyond that. Our second speaker will then follow on with a more focused discussion about understanding the spread of disease on a university campus. And our final speaker will talk about technology that is a wearable technology that you can use to help understand the progression of a disease. So please welcome Pinar Keskinocak, who will talk to us about infectious disease modeling.
Thank you very much, Gregory, and it's truly an honor and a pleasure to be here, and thank you all for participating. So this is going to be a 10,000 feet, very quick overview of some aspects of infectious disease modeling and how your community has been helping modelers like me and others in populating these diseases with meaningful data and in other ways. So when we think about disease modeling, really there are two key components. One of them is the natural history of the disease, essentially how it progresses within an individual after contracting the disease. And then the second component is how it spreads in a population. So in looking at our model results, there are several potential metrics of interest. Such as how many new infections do we see per time period, daily, weekly, what is the timing and magnitude of the peak. This is basically when the daily new infections reach their highest level. I'm sure you all have heard the word peak quite a bit over the past couple of months. We are interested in the total number of infections or the percentage of the population infected. That tells us something about the broader impact of the disease in the population. We may be interested in adverse outcomes, such as the number of people who are hospitalized or who die. And then, of course, we are interested in the resource needs, such as how many hospital beds we may need, ventilators, or other types of resources. So the percentage of population infected gives us an idea about the overall impact, like I said, as well as the resource needs across time. The peak helps us understand when we are really, really stressed in terms of our resources, how is the situation is going to look like? Are we going to have enough capacity to meet the needs, especially when the disease is around its peak? So we look at these numbers, metrics, and estimates together to get an idea both about the impact and also whether or not we will be able to respond properly. And these metrics typically are of interest, not just in aggregate numbers, but also by dissecting into specific details, such as by age group or geography or specific subpopulations, because the impact typically is not uniform across populations. So we are interested in the impact both geographically and over time, as well as at the subpopulation level. So we are, of course, in addition to understanding how the disease would spread, the natural history, if we do nothing, but we are also very interested in modeling and understanding the impact of interventions. The models can inform us if we have limited amount of resources to invest into these interventions, or for whatever reason, we may be facing challenges, for example, educating people to focus on a particular intervention. So we wanna understand how to allocate these limited efforts and resources across different interventions. And what we do could again depend or change geographically or over time or by subpopulation, not necessarily static across the course of the disease. And finally, I keep coming back to resource allocation. This is an area where epidemiology models that inform us about the disease spread are combined in creative ways with optimization models. This is coming from my field. To give us a good sense of what might be the best way to allocate limited resources. So going a little bit into the disease spread, part one is the natural history, how the disease progresses within an individual. Typically, an individual would go through different stages after being exposed to the disease. And I'm giving the example from COVID-19 here. Some people will go through a symptomatic phase. Others might go through the disease stages completely asymptomatic or with very mild symptoms. And then the majority might recover. Some people might need hospitalization or might die as a result of complications. So in the models, we try to capture these different stages of the progression of the disease in an individual and how a person progresses across these different stages will depend on their age as well as underlying conditions in the absence of any treatment or intervention. So all of these different parameters come to the models from the work of others in the medicine field or other fields such as yours. So you may have heard about SIR model in the literature or SEIR models in the literature. These are kind of the basic versions of these models that you will typically see. And they capture the key components. For example, if we simply look at, is somebody currently infected and not worry about whether or not they are whether they are symptomatic or not, that would be our infection stage. So that's where you will see the I for infected. And then the recovered phase, you know, could be combined by including some of these other stages. So these are the simple versions, simpler versions of the models that you may have heard about or seen in the literature. So our mind has been totally occupied with COVID, of course, over the past many months. But when we more broadly think about infectious diseases, there are many others which are transmitted through different pathways. So COVID is a respiratory disease. Flu, whether it's seasonal flu or pandemic flu, also falls into the same category. But then we have other diseases, for example, such as malaria or guinea worm, which are transmitted through vectors. Other diseases, the environment plays a role in the transmission. So the models still follow relatively similar structure as the one I described before. But if you are modeling a disease such as malaria, you would not only model the human population, but you would also model the mosquito population, as well as the interactions between them. So my research team has done work in several of these diseases, and I'll be able to follow up later in case any of you are interested in those others. So the second component is the spread of the disease across the population. Again, I'm gonna give an example from COVID. My team uses agent-based models, which develops and uses agent-based models. And these models actually capture some of these interactions at a very detailed level, unlike some of the models such as SIR or SEIR, where they are captured at a higher level, but not necessarily at the individual level. So in agent-based model, we can actually model each individual as an agent, and we can capture the interactions between them. For example, agents would belong to a household of different sizes, where the input about the household sizes and so on would come from data. And then they would interact in with their household members at a closer level. They would also belong to different peer groups, depending on their age, which might be workplace or school. And again, information, data about these workplace sizes, school sizes, et cetera, would come from the data that we have. And then finally, they would interact in a broader community, such as, you know, visits to grocery stores and other places where they would get together with other people who are not necessarily within their workplace or household. And as you can imagine, we also model these interactions with a different possibility of disease transmission. If you live with someone in the same household, the chances of the disease transmission is much higher compared to the interactions that happen in the community. So lots of data goes into populating this portion of the model in terms of how these interactions take place in practice. Now, a ton of model parameters, I'm not gonna go through these, but just to give you a little bit of a flavor. So what you see on the left is a sample of the parameters that go into the natural history. And then what you see on the right is a sample set of parameters that go into the estimates of resource allocation. So we project the progression or the spread of the disease, but then we also project the need for resources. Particularly, I'm showing some examples here from healthcare-related resources as a result of the disease. So this is an area where researchers from computing play a very significant role in helping us estimate some of these parameters, whether they're at the individual level or at the community level or in terms of the resource needs, such as hospital beds, ICU beds, and so on in case of COVID. So resource allocation and interventions. So interventions, typically we can put them into two big picture categories, pharmaceutical interventions such as vaccines and antivirals. And these usually do not become available early on if we have a new infectious disease such as COVID. For others that have been around for a long time, they are available. And then non-pharmaceutical interventions are primarily behavioral interventions, such as school closures, travel restrictions, people voluntarily engaging in different types of physical distancing, wearing masks, and things like that. And then we also could think about some of these combined strategies or interventions, such as testing, tracing, and isolation. By themselves, they may have limited effectiveness, but when you put them together, in combination, they are very impactful. Compliance can change a lot. This is another aspect that we try to put into these models when we evaluate these intervention scenarios. This can change by geography. It can change over time. People might be less compliant with certain interventions earlier on if they think the disease is not that serious, and then the compliance might increase, and then towards the end, it might go down again. So all of these different scenarios go into some of these disease spread models, so we can actually evaluate their impact. And then, of course, the big picture again is how to allocate where, when, how to allocate limited set of resources, whether it's vaccines, antivirals, efforts in education, educating the public, and so on. So those are, again, areas where data and information coming from the field of computing help us a lot. For example, when we think about compliance, I will give one example, say mobility data. We may not know exactly who's complying via surveys and so on. We may get limited information, but when we look at mobility data, that gives us a very good idea or understanding of people's, you know, travel patterns, and that could be used as an indicator of their compliance with some of these physical distancing measures, such as shelter in place or other types of recommendations. So I'm gonna share two small pieces of results from some of my team's work, where we looked at a variety of scenarios to project the disease spread. So on the left side the graph, you see a very typical way we would look at these disease model outcomes. You have dates on the x-axis, and then on the y-axis, we have one of those metrics that are of interest to us. In this particular example, I'm showing you daily new COVID-19 infections. This is specifically for the state of Georgia. And then you can see here the zigzag is the actual cases, or our estimate of the actual cases, also considering the fact of underreporting. And then the smooth lines are some of these projections coming from our model. And then what you see on the right side are some additional scenarios that we tested, looking at school reopening scenarios that were shared with us by Georgia Department of Education. What if we delay the opening, start online? What if we have kids come to school every other day in two completely separate cohorts? What's the impact of some of these potential scenarios? And one takeaway for us was that actually having this alternating day scenario, along with slightly delaying the opening, significantly reduces the potential number of infections in the community. So these are the kinds of results that we would get from these models and communicate with policymakers. So going back to the data and how the UbiComp community and others, again, really, really help modelers or could help even further moving forward. Any kind of information about transmission patterns and probabilities these vary wildly depending on the disease, whether we are indoor, outdoor. For example, when we think of COVID, the impact of an intervention on reducing the transmission, how much does it help to wear a mask, depending on the type of mask and the duration and, you know, our proximity to the person. So these are all the types of info that would come, you know, from the work of different communities and then would be used by modelers. Surveillance is another area which is very important, symptom-based. Some of it could be symptom-based, can be inferred based on symptoms, whether or not somebody is infected, even if we may not have a test available due to capacity or other limitations. And finally, I think an area where I see a lot of potential for this community to help modelers is for us to better understand behaviors. Right, so you can take a horse to the water, but you can't make the horse drink the water. So how do people interact? To what degree do they follow the recommendations? How much they comply with interventions? And not everybody was sheltering in place when we have the shelter in place orders in effect. So these, some of these behavioral input or data that's really essential in how we create scenarios in the model is where we would really benefit a lot from additional computing. So thank you very much, and looking forward to the discussion.